In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As winter days dim and bow to early darkness, you, God of light, set watch in the night sky and beckon the wise to follow. When hope hangs low in the human heart, you, loving Creator, kindle compassion, breathing life into the early embers of change and empathy. Relight a candle this morning for hope, sending prayers into the inky heavens and dreams deep into the human soul. And if you can light your candle at this time. As Advent dawns, God of all hope, shine your light on the story of the saints who journeyed before us. May the seeds they planted in the world, peace, joy, and love, take hold in our hearts and stretch towards the light. We light a candle for hope. May it light our way.
Rejoice, rejoice, the Lord is risen.
Let us pray. O God of power and might, your Son shows us the way of service, and in him we have the riches of your grace. Give us the wisdom to know what's right and to serve the world you have made. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading this morning is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 64, verses 1 to 9. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in their ways. But you were angry and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hands of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. You are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
He has come.
Gospel. This is the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, "In those days after the suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Let's do a little thought experiment this morning. What are the days when your understanding of the world dramatically shifted? Not dates that are personally meaningful to you, not birthdays and anniversaries, but the days when you went to bed knowing that the world had changed in some irreversible way. My guess is that if we wrote down all of our answers, we would actually have a whole bunch in common. November 23rd, 1963, January 28th, 1986, September 11th, 2001, September 15th, 2008. There's life before that date, and there's life after that date. One date that we would probably overlook is June 29th, 2007, which was the day the first iPhone was released. Now, what's significant about that date is not the phone itself. After all, that was obsolete within a year. But how it changed the way that we relate to information. On June 28th, if you wanted to know tomorrow's forecast or who won the game last night, or whether it was Luke Wilson or Owen Wilson in the Darjeeling Limited, you had to read a newspaper, listen to the radio, or find a computer. In short, you had to wait. We hate waiting. The waiting that once seemed like a normal part of your life now feels like an impossible burden to bear. You might skip out on your favorite restaurant if, God forbid, you have to wait for a table. Two-day shipping, novel as it was, has become one-day shipping, and now has become just same-day shipping. Telling someone they need to wait feels almost offensive. Don't you know how valuable my time is? We've got places to be, things to do, people to see. Our fraught relationship with waiting is best captured right out in front of the church here. And maybe you've had this experience before, where you're making a left hand into the church entrance, and the person behind you doesn't want to wait, so they squeeze by you in this impossibly tiny space, only to pull up to a red light, where they have to, well, wait. And that sort of sums it all up. That underneath all of our hustling and efficiency, we still have to wait. We wait for test results. We wait for letters of acceptance or rejection. We wait for decisions. We wait for life, and we wait for death. Your iPhone is nice. It can tell you that it's going to rain tomorrow, that the Giants lost, that it was Owen Wilson in the Darjeeling Limited. But there's no way to get through life without having to wait. Today's reading from Isaiah is the petition, the lament of a people who've been forced to wait. This reading was written around the 6th century BC, and it was after the Israelites were coming out of their exile experience. The Babylonian Empire had been sacked by the Persians. The Persians didn't want to pay for all these Israelites being imprisoned, so they let them go home. And that changes everything for the Israelites. They have a chance at more freedom. They have a chance to go home. That dark period in their history is coming to a close. And this should be good. But it doesn't happen all at once. It isn't as if the Babylonian leave and things just go back to the way they were beforehand. People have to figure out how to rebuild their homes. They have to figure out how to rebuild their relationships. And they have to figure out where things stand with God. Has God abandoned them during this exile period? Well, time will tell. And maybe that puts the beginning of this reading in a little bit of a different light. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. God used to be present to our ancestors, the author suggests. God tore open the heavens at Sinai and made mountains quake. God used to do awesome deeds. But now? Well, now you'll have to wait and see. What is it exactly about waiting that's so difficult for us? Why do we go to all lengths to try to extricate it from our lives? It could be that it's just hard to make plans. I feel like my life is on pause while I'm waiting. Or it could be the uncertainty. For the Israelites, are we still in this covenant with God, or do we need to find some other God to be in relationship with? But at a deeper level, it might be that waiting forces us to live with longing. It forces us to reckon with the fact that there are things in the world, things in our homes, things in our hearts that don't feel whole. Waiting means having to live with desire. I don't know what it is you're longing after this season. Maybe you're longing to see family and friends again. Maybe you're longing for more stability and predictability. Maybe you're longing for a moment of solitude or a glimpse of community. Maybe you're longing for justice and peace in our world. And maybe you're longing for something else. Now, staying with that longing is difficult. It's even more difficult at this time of the year when we're bombarded with idealized images of holiday celebrations where everything looks perfect. And it can be tempting to pretend that everything is just fine, that we're doing okay, we're doing just well, thanks, that we have nothing to complain about. Because the gap between how we're doing and how we feel like we should be doing is so big. Lots of churches offer these things called blue Christmas services. And these are special Christmas services for people who are going through something difficult and they don't want the usual festivities of Christmas. And these are well-intentioned, and I don't want to be uncharitable to people doing their level best. But if you want a blue Christmas service, a space where you can hold your desire and your longing and your grief, you should really just go to an Advent service. It's not a coincidence that most communities that do blue Christmas services don't really do Advent. They just do a month of Christmas carols. They don't wait. And so they miss all that imagery of expectation and hope and longing. Just look at that last verse of today's opening hymn. Our hope and expectation, O Jesus, now appear. Arise, O sun, so longed for o'er this benighted sphere. With hearts and hands uplifted, we plead, O Lord, to see the day of earth's redemption that sets your people free. In a world that wants to hurry everything up to make everything more efficient and more seamless and more perfect, Advent carves out a space for us to pay attention to where we experience a lack of wholeness. If we look at the world and say, this is not the way things should be, then Advent says, don't rush past that too quickly. Advent reminds us that longing is not ingratitude, desire is not selfish, and lament is not complaining. It's a season of our longing after God and God's peace. And when we pay attention to that longing, to that desire, what we discover is that it is not simply we who long after God, but God who longs after us. That God enters into our lives again and again to renew and transform creation. When we recognize the gap between the world as it is and the world that God intends, we discover God's consistent desire to overflow into our lives and the lives of our neighbors. So as we begin this Advent season, I encourage you to make space for that longing, that desire, and that wish for wholeness. Don't overwhelm it with distractions, don't minimize it as whining, and don't write it off as pessimism. But remember that your longing, your desire, and your hope points the way toward the life of the world to come. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Use me.
commit yourself as we join the church around the world, confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead.
On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven.
He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
O God of power and might, tear open the heavens and come quickly to this weary world. Hear our prayers for everyone in need. We pray for the ministry we share in Christ's name. Open our hearts to your call of justice, peace, and healing. Attune us to the needs of the world as you draw near. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for this planet in need of restoration, for devastated habitats, polluted waters, thawing ice, blazing fires, swelling floods, and long-lasting droughts. Renew the face of the earth and our relationship to it. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for all people who care for others in our community and around the world. Fill them with compassion and the power to respond, with justice for those who are oppressed, with welcome for those who are excluded, and relief for those who suffer. We pray especially this week for the people of Myanmar and Thailand. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for people who are in crisis as the seasons change, for those without houses facing severe weather, for those who are unemployed or underemployed, for those in poverty or facing food insecurity. Relieve their burdens, sustain their bodies, and ease their minds. And if you have any petitions, I invite you to offer those at this time.
Nita, Barbara, Rick, Rayanne.
My mom.
Dylan.
My sister, Lynn.
Tim.
Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for people in our families and congregation who live with depression, anxiety, chronic pain, addiction, and other illnesses invisible to us. Ease their suffering and support them when they struggle. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We offer these prayers in the name of the one who never turns back from us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
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 And gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. One more slide. There we go. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation.
The Lord is the King of Kings.
All right. At this time, we open things up for any announcements, joys, and concerns. Did anyone have anything you wanted to share with the congregation? No. Okay. A few things I just want to let you know. One is today we have our last fall Sunday school session at 4. Today is also the last day to bring in bags for seafarers. Carol and Bob will be in the parking lot from 11 to 1. This is the last day for those. You can still do, the CFA is accepting food donations all the time. And then the cards for Christian Healthcare residents, my Dropbox is outside there. By the Memorial Garden, it will be there until December 13th. So you still have time for that. This Wednesday, we're starting Advent programming at 7. We'll have a time of prayer and reflection and conversation. Should be about half an hour or so. We're using a curriculum that's from the same company that did the kits that the kids got last week. So there's no prep needed. You can do one, you can do four, you can do whatever. I invite you to come to that. And we're starting to plan Christmas stuff. And if you got the newsletter, you saw sort of the outline of what we're gonna be doing for services. For the pre-recorded service, we're gonna be working on that sort of earlier than the other things. If you're interested in reading or doing prayers for that, please let me know. You'll have to do a voice memo or a video of yourself and then send that to me. And this takes some more time, which is why we're doing that now. But we're trying to get as many people in that video who are not me as possible. So if you're interested in doing that, please just shoot me an email and we'll work something out. So that is all I have in the way of announcements today. Let's go to the next slide. And I invite you to receive the blessing. This blessing is an adaptation of Paul's letter from Philippians. May God, who began a good work in you, bring it to completion. May your love overflow more and more with knowledge and insight. And may your life be lived to the glory and praise of God. Amen. Go in peace. The Lord is near. Thanks be to God. All right. Thank you, Jason.
Pleasure.